En calidad de presidente de la Junta Consultiva de la Universidad Casa Grande, me es muy grato presentar a la expositora de la Universidad de Harvard que escucharemos a continuación, la doctora Mary Lee Grindle. Para nosotros ha sido de especial interés mantener contacto con lo que ocurre en el mundo y lo que pasa en Harvard es parte de esa condición. Gobernabilidad es otro de nuestros temas claves y cómo se administran las universidades también. Sobre todo ello tendremos una magnífica oportunidad.
Estamos muy honrados de tener con nosotros tan distinguida visita en la universidad y presentar a la doctora Mary Lee Grindle. Me permito llamar al decano de la Facultad de Administración y Ciencias Políticas, economista Modesto Correa, máster en Administración Pública de la Universidad de Harvard y MBA de la George Washington University. Fue presidente y gobernador del Harvard Club del Ecuador, miembro del BID en Washington, director y presidente del directorio del Banco Central del Ecuador, gobernador del Fondo Monetario Internacional, ministro de Finanzas, presidente del directorio de la Bolsa de Valores de Guayaquil, gerente del Banco de Guayaquil, entre otros importantes cargos en nuestro país y el exterior. Sin más introducciones, los dejo con Modesto Correa.
Pues muchas gracias, Daniela, por tu presentación y muchas gracias a todos ustedes por asistir a este evento organizado por Casa Grande y rendir un homenaje a la doctora Marilyn Grindle, una amiga ya de nuestro país, de nuestra ciudad y de esta universidad. A Marilyn Grindle tuve la oportunidad de conocerla hace unos 4 años, había escuchado mucho de ella. En un par de viajes que hice por Cambridge, en una ocasión ella tuvo la gentileza de brindarnos un almuerzo en el Faculty Club y me tocó la suerte de estar sentado al lado de ella y ahí pudimos conversar. Y recuerdo que yo le pregunté, Marilyn, ¿le gustaría conocer Ecuador? Y ella me contestó, cuando me inviten. Bueno, y aquí está después de algún tiempo. Marilyn Grindle es una cientista política, profesora de Desarrollo Internacional, posee el Faculty Club de Maestrías en Gestión Pública y directora del Centro de Estudios Latinoamericanos, Ray David Rockefeller, de la Universidad de Harvard. Ella ha hecho muchos estudios y recibió en el año 91 un premio especial, Manuel Carvalho, a la excelencia académica. Marilyn Grindle es catedrática de la Escuela de John F. Kennedy, y directora del Centro David Rockefeller, como ya les había indicado. Graduada en Ciencias Políticas y con un PhD de MIT, la profesora Grindle es una especialista en análisis comparativo de desarrollo e implementación de políticas de gobierno y de manejo público en países en vía de desarrollo con enfoque particular en América Latina. Entre sus publicaciones están En busca del desarrollo rural, Burócratas, políticos y campesinos en México, El Estado y el campo, Enfrentando al Estado, Reformas audaces, A pesar de las dificultades y Hacerlo localmente. Esta es una parte de las publicaciones que ella tiene a lo largo de su larga vida académica. Y si ustedes van a una página web de Harvard y ven ahí su nombre, van a encontrar todas las publicaciones que ella ha realizado. Además, es autora de numerosos artículos de discusión académica, ensayos y proyectos. Como educadora, publicó el libro The Public Choices and Public Change, Opciones Públicas y Cambios de Política. Este lo escribió con John Thomas. Su función como directora del Centro David Rockefeller le ha permitido visitar muchos países en América Latina y el Caribe y participar en seminarios y paneles. Su relación con nuestros países precede a su carrera académica con una anécdota, que fue miembro del Cuerpo de Paz en República Dominicana en los años 1967-1969. ¿Son correctos sus años? Y su visita a nuestro país nos honra debido a su amplia y destacada trayectoria como docente e investigadora de la política económica del sector público en Latinoamérica. Yo creo que la experiencia de una escuela como la John F. Kennedy, la Escuela de Gobierno, la Universidad de Harvard, es en doble sentido, porque allí hay, por ejemplo, un programa que se llama el programa Mason Program, en donde es de los principales miembros de ese programa. Allí van gente que ha estado en la vida pública, en gobiernos nacionales, en gobiernos locales, con experiencia. Ahí van líderes públicos que han pasado por y que pasan por funciones públicas de todos los continentes. Es decir, ahí se nutre en esa facultad de toda la experiencia de gente que va allá y que va a estudiar, que va a obtener más experiencia, que va a investigar. Y ahí es donde justamente Marilyn Grinda está presente para poder con ellos enriquecerse en ambos lados, en ambos sentidos, en una doble dirección. De la escuela de gobierno John F. Kennedy han salido muchos líderes en el mundo, es decir, y en América Latina en lo particular. Y ella ha tenido aquí, en esta oportunidad, ayer un almuerzo que tuvimos en Quito, y hoy día también, un desayuno, y ahora también en un almuerzo, y hoy día acá en esta sala, se ha podido encontrar con algunos de sus alumnos que fueron sus discípulos. Fueron sus discípulos, y qué grato para ella ha sido volver a encontrarlos. Doctora Marilyn Grinde, bienvenida al Ecuador, bienvenido a Guayaquil. Esta es su casa, esta es su casa grande. Gracias.
Pues muchísimas gracias, Modesto. Es para mí un honor y un placer estar aquí con ustedes. Estoy en el Ecuador después de 12 años de no estar aquí y puedo afirmar que los cambios han sido tremendos y buenos. Eso los veo en todas partes y es muy impresionante todo el crecimiento, todo lo que ha pasado en este país. Les agradezco mucho su presencia. Quiero agradecer mucho a la Universidad Casa Grande, a Marcia Gilbert de Babra, disculpe, a Leticia Orsés, la vicerectora, a Modesto Correa, mi amigo de hace 4 años, a Daniela y a Mariela Ortega. Y también a María Sara Gijón, que es la presidenta del Harvard Club del Ecuador, que también coordinó esa visita. Ha sido una visita de mucho aprendizaje para mí y el problema que tengo es que hace unos 40 años, 45 años, dejé mi corazón en América Latina, entonces cada vez tengo que volver para buscar mi corazón. Pues muchísimas gracias por la oportunidad. Voy a hacer una pequeña charla sobre la reforma de la educación. Y antes de empezar, quiero enfatizar 4 cosas. Primero, no soy especialista en la educación, aunque voy a hablar de la educación. Lo que voy a decir, la charla es un estudio de hace varios años de tipo muy académico para tratar de entender el proceso político de la reforma. No tanto cuál es la reforma, pero más bien cuál es el proceso de introducción, de aceptación y de implementación de la reforma. La tercera cosa es que estas reformas, estos estudios ya son del pasado, pero creo que, espero que hay algo en las lecciones que he extraído de una serie de casos de estudio que tal vez sirven para la aplicación en la época actual. La cuarta cosa es que quiero empezar con la observación de que no es suficiente en la vida pública tener una buena idea. Tener una buena idea es muy bueno, pero hay que pensar también en su factibilidad política, su aceptación y la capacidad que tiene para atraer apoyo para que se puede ir de ser una idea hasta ser algo en la realidad. Entonces, para que no estemos acá hasta medianoche, voy a cambiar a inglés. Pues, para empezar, I am not a specialist in education. I'm going to be talking about education, but I'm not an education specialist. I am interested in the politics of policy reform. All of us want to see good things happen in our countries. We want to see change. But in order to make that happen, it seems to me, we have to understand the political process of finding, of thinking about and communicating about policy reform. In fact, if you were to do a study of all the reform initiatives that there are every year in every country in the world, you would find that most of them fail. Most of them fracasan, no? And they fail for a variety of reasons. They fail because of poor planning, because of lack of resources, because of poor administration, falta de capacidad, because of poor communication. One very important reason that they fail is that they are, many, many reforms are politically contentious and are defeated by those who oppose them. And so I believe that very, very frequently we overlook the bureaucratic and political analysis of politics because we fall in love with our good ideas. We think I have the best idea for change in the world and everybody else is going to love it too. And then we discover that there is actually opposition, and often that opposition can defeat a policy. So what I'm going to present is about some research that I did several years ago in 5 Latin American countries. I'll start off by talking a little bit about what is a contentious policy, what is a contentious policy reform, and then look at the kinds of education policy reforms that I think are quite contentious, and then ask an interesting question. These reforms that I'm going to be talking about are very, very contentious. They encounter a great deal of opposition. Yet every once in a while, a reform succeeds. It is possible to be approved and implemented in a contentious political environment. And the question then is, how does that happen? How do we, from time to time, find very contentious policies that actually become politically acceptable and implementable? So that's what Despite the Odds is all about. A ver, con Spanglish, no? A brief word about the contentiousness of policy, the conflictiveness of policy. This is kind of classic political economy. Policies will be very, very difficult and contentious when those who are going to be losers, okay, the people who will lose from change, are very highly organized, are very vocal, and are very politically important. For example, in some countries this may be the unions, or it may be an association of business people who feel that they are going to lose from a reform. They're well organized, they're very vocal, and they're politically important. On the other side, those who will benefit from a reform are in these kinds of situations are often unorganized, they live in dispersed areas, and they don't have much political voice. Think about parents in education. Parents are not organized usually. They don't, they live they are not well organized, and they often don't have political voice. At the same time, we can think about institutions. Most institutions, almost by definition, are biased against change. So when you have those who are opposed, highly organized, and institutions like ministries biased against change, you're likely to get conditions that suggest that a policy reform will fail. Now, I'm going to give you an example. Two different kinds of education reform. Reforms that have to do with access, cobertura, getting more kids in school. Okay, a policy reform that the purpose of that proposes to bring more children into school, get more coverage, more access. What do you have to do? Okay, as a policymaker, as a government, what do you do? Well, you build more schools. You hire more administrators. You increase the budgets of a ministry because they're doing more work, so they need more resources. You hire teachers. You hire many more teachers, and you buy equipment. You buy desks, and you buy chairs, and you buy pencils and textbooks. Now, if you think about, these are all things that cost money. These can be difficult, but if you think about this from a political perspective, you are actually providing benefits, lots of benefits. You're creating jobs, you're making it possible because you're building more schools, there are construction projects, you have to get people, hire people to make new textbooks and pencils and things. You're increasing the budgets of administrative units, and if you're in a situation where an organization is growing, like a Ministry of Education, that ministry is becoming more powerful, it has more budget. These are benefits for those who are receiving the jobs and the contracts and the budget and the power. So, what happens usually in a situation like this? Unions of teachers are very, very supportive. They like these kinds of reforms. Why? There's more teachers. For every new teacher, there's a new union member. For every new union member, there's more power. There's more more dues are paid, and so the unions can become more powerful. Politicians like these kinds of reforms a lot. All of us know, everywhere in the world, what politicians like to do best is go to a local community and cut the ribbon on a new school or a new health clinic. Politicians like to see new schools being built. Okay, it provides them with something tangible to show. Communities like these kinds of policies too. They get a new school. They're very pleased with that. And because you can see the school and you can see the new teacher, often voters support the change. Okay? This is a set of policies about education that are not very conflictive. They can be difficult, they can be expensive, they're administratively complex sometimes, but politically they are very happy kinds of policies. Now, let's look at a different kind of policy. Policies that have to do with improving the quality of education. When you have all of the children in the schools, that's good, but sometimes they're not getting a very good education. So in Latin America, over the last 20 years, a great deal of attention has been given to improving the quality of education. What do you have to do to improve the quality of education? Well, you have to improve management. You have to tighten up on the administration of schools. You have to increase efficiency, so use the same amount of resources but get more results. You have to put teachers under pressure to perform better. You have to put parents under pressure to send their children to school. You have to put the children under pressure to do better in school, improve accountability. Very frequently, you need to increase the engagement of local communities. If we think about that from the perspective of many of those involved in these kinds of reforms, what this can turn out to mean is loss, costs, okay? Jobs, teachers who are not doing a good job can lose their jobs. If you're trying to increase efficiency, you may want to fire some administrators who are not doing a good job. If you want to improve quality, sometimes what you want to do is decentralize. If you decentralize, often that means that the ministry at the center loses power. The principals may lose power to the local community or the teachers. And there's new demands and expectations. So it can be a very, very difficult thing. What happens then? Typically, unions of teachers oppose these reforms. They do not like these kinds of reforms. I will say nothing about Ecuador, but perhaps you have seen this kind of response. Bureaucrats do, they don't say, oh, no, I'm not gonna do this. Often what they do is say, yes, oh, what a nice idea. Yes, they do nothing, okay? They can sabotage the reform if they don't want to see it implemented. Politicians, because the unions are often in opposition to these kinds of reforms, politicians often don't want to support them because they would be putting themselves in opposition to very powerful interests. And quality-enhancing reforms to improve quality, take a lot of time before you see results. And because of that, voters don't reward improvements in education because, at least in the short term, they can't see them. Okay, so these are not very contentious education reforms. These are very contentious education reforms. Latin American countries have done an excellent job, most of them, in getting most kids into school, into primary school and now into secondary school. Okay? They have done a very good job. If you look at the international rankings in terms of how many children are in school, it's almost 100% in many countries. But now Latin American countries are having to face these kinds of problems. So, what did I do? Just going back to the figure, if you look at these contentious reforms, you can imagine that any effort to improve the quality of education is going to is going to fail because of the opposition to it. But every once in a while, they actually succeed. And why is this? Well, it's because policy reforms develop over time, and over time, there are opportunities for smart reformers to intervene and make and alter the politics of opposition. Okay. So what did I do? This was a study I did a long time ago. It was published as a book in 2004, I believe. 5 cases from Latin America. They were all about trying to improve quality. They all encountered major opposition. There were riots in the streets. There were tent cities that were set up when the teachers tried to block the anyone from getting into the ministries. Some people ended up in jail. Cars were set on fire in some places. So there was often a great deal of conflict. But interestingly, 4 of these 5 reforms were actually approved and implemented. So how did that happen? What I'm going to say is just some generalizations about what happened in each of the cases. This Minas Gerais, as you know, is a state, a very large state in Brazil, 30 million people, so that's bigger than Ecuador, right? And Mexico, Nicaragua, Bolivia, and Ecuador. The dates, this was the principal reformer, okay? The reformers had teams of people who worked with them, but each of these reforms had a lead reformer, a president or a minister. These lead reformers helped make some very important strategic decisions. They thought very strategically about timing. When is the best time to introduce, best time politically to introduce a new reform? Okay, maybe right after an election, or maybe right after there's been some kind of protest. It varied from country, but all of them thought about the timing. All of them used their powers of appointment to bring in other reformers into positions of importance. So they brought in vice ministers and general directors and others into their ministries who would support their reform, to build a reform team. So they used their appointment power. They tried to weaken or marginalize the opposition, the unions in this case. And often they did things that were a bit ugly, things that we wouldn't like to think about, but it was strategic. These were strategic decisions that they made. They framed the issue in a way that brought political support. That is, they communicated about the reform in a way that helped them build support from public opinion and from particularly important groups in the population. And in some cases, they actually campaigned on the issue. We often think of design teams as being technocrats, and the people who sit around the table to design a new policy, we often think, oh, these are the specialists. These aren't politicians. They're not people who are engaged in politics. They're specialists. But what I saw in these studies was that the design teams were actually part of the politics of moving a reform forward. They agreed with each other. They were placed in an important position where they could have influence. They established networks throughout government and with the international communities. One of the most interesting things that they did was to act as gatekeeper. ¿Cuál sería la palabra para gatekeepers? Los que. Okay, muy bien. So they were the ones who decided who was invited in to participate in the discussion. So they acted as gatekeepers. Sometimes they wanted lots of people, lots of different interests as participants. Sometimes they limited it, but it was their decision whether to open the doors or not. And they worked very closely with the politician who was the reform leader. The major opposition, as you could imagine, was that in each of these cases was the teachers' union. What did they do? They did almost the same thing in every single country. They went on strike, often violent strikes. They said, we'll be happy to change, but you have to pay us more money first. They said, you are trying to destroy the unions. Often they were right. There was, this, they claimed this. They said, you didn't consult us. We were left out of the discussion. They weren't always, but they always said they were left out of the discussion. They said, you are trying to privatize public education, okay? And the next thing that's going to happen is the parents are going to have to pay for the education. And this actually, many of the things that they did didn't win them many friends in public. But this one, because this was the days of, you know, all of the neoliberal reforms, when they said, this is just one more neoliberal reform, you know, imposed by Washington, you know, to destroy our public education, if that's what they said, okay, that many, many people believed them. They had their own proposals, but those proposals usually weren't very specific. They would say things like, education is very important. Yes. They would say, teachers are a national treasure. But they had no real plan, right? But they did have these proposals, and in some cases they used this, their opportunities, not just to say, you know, that the education reform is bad, they used it to say the government is bad. And you can see there's a tick on the case of Ecuador there. The great part, the cases that are in gray, are cases where there was negotiation with the teachers' unions. Okay? In these cases, there was not real negotiation with the teachers' unions. Okay? So, if we go to the next, you'll see that there were some consequences to this. Where there was negotiation, the reform could be introduced all at once because it had been negotiated. So you could say, okay, from tomorrow, you know, all the schools will be reformed. Where there wasn't negotiation, the reforms had to be introduced very gradually because there was still a great deal of opposition. In these cases, in the negotiated cases, the reforms were mandatory. In the other cases, they were voluntary. That is, the teachers or the schools would elect to be part of the reform. And there was, in the cases of Nicaragua and Bolivia, there was individual incentives in the sense of, if you become part of the reform, you will get paid more, or you will have an opportunity to have a training, participate in more training. In the other cases, that was not true. You notice that one of the cases fell off the grid, the case of Ecuador. Okay? You could probably suspect what happened, given the date. Okay? What happened to the education reform at this point, okay, was a massive national crisis that was both economic and political. It had very little to do with education, but it destroyed the opportunity for the education reform. Okay, so often education reforms fail not because of education, but because of these larger issues. Okay. Did we? Yes, okay, good. Okay, all of these reforms involved decentralization. Okay. These were all efforts to take national ministries and give more power either to local governments or local schools. What happened with when the reforms were implemented is that instead of all the decisions about going forward being made at the center in the ministry, they were being made in the states or in the municipalities or in the schools, in the local governments. So that how the governors and the mayors and the school principals responded to the reforms was really what was determining whether the reforms would be successful or not. And the unions continued to press at national levels, but then they also began pressuring at more local levels. Okay. What didn't I find? Okay. I expected, when I started this study, to discover that interest groups, like business groups, were demanding that governments pay more attention to education. I didn't find that, and that surprised me. Okay. I also found there was very little participation in these reforms. The reforms went forward, they succeeded, but with very little participation. Once again, I expected business interest, because this was a time of globalization. I expected that business associations would be demanding better schools so that they could compete in a global labor market. Okay? I didn't find that. The international financial institutions, the UNESCO, the World Bank, the Inter-American Development Bank, were often part of these reforms, but they didn't set the agenda. They weren't the initiators. These were not reforms that were imposed. These were reforms that came from reformers. What they did to have influence, their influence came mostly from the ideas that they brought rather than the money that they brought, okay? Which would probably be different in other parts of the world where the needs would be much greater. Okay, so just some conclusions. I do think that a great deal was achieved during the decade of the 1990s in thinking about and beginning to work on the problems of improving the quality of education in many Latin American countries, but clearly much remained to be done. And one of the very, very good things about the decade of the 2000s, the decade that we've just passed, is that the issue of the quality of education got back on national political agendas very importantly. I think the education reformers, in the cases that I looked at, made a number of very good strategic decisions. They got out ahead of the opposition. They used their appointment power very wisely to build teams of reformers around them. They communicated the issues very well. They used their design teams as a part of their reform strategy. And they were also very smart in many cases deciding, should we have negotiations or not? What should we negotiate about? What should we not negotiate about? But it does seem to me that there were several things they could have done better, and hopefully the reformers of the current period are doing this. I think they could have used information much more wisely. There is a great deal of information in Latin American countries about education. Okay? That could be used in very simple ways, it seems to me, to build public support. For example, if you look at the international rankings of Latin American countries on international tests of math and reading, Latin American countries are down here. Well, you could use that as a way of getting people interested you could use dropout rates and repetition rates as a way of building political support for change. I think more can be done about that. I think the reformers could have spent more time trying to engage particularly the business community, because of the business community in most countries is well organized and strong, and could have tried to engage them more and engage parents and civil society and NGOs more. And I think that they could have anticipated that they would lose power once decentralization happened. That was what happened to, once the governors and the mayors and the school principals became the important actors, the reformers at the center really lost their capacity to manage the politics of reform. And therefore you got very different results coming from very different parts of the world.